Yep. We are doing it. Welcome to the page, everybody. Chaos here. Not too long ago, we ranked every single pistol in Call of Duty history. There were 84 pistols. It's the definitive ranking list of pistols. And I asked you guys, if you supported this, if you like this longer content, this more in-depth content, let me know. And you guys have just been blowing it away. Somebody even said it was like Chaos took his top 10s and put extended mags on them. Well, my friends, nowhere to go but up, right? We are going to rank every single SMG in COD history. They're one of the main weapon types in COD. Everybody has their own idea of which is the best, which is the worst. The MP7, the MP5, the Scorpion Evo. Well, guess what? We have a definitive list. We are ranking 123 SMGs from dead last all the way to first. From COD 4 all the way to Black Ops Cold War. So drop a like and let's get into this madness. At number 123, the Black Ops 1 Uzi. It's one of my least favorite SMGs in COD history. It's absolute hot garbage, high rate of fire, high recoil, low damage, terrible range, and some of the worst iron sights in COD history. This gun truly had it all if you were trying to hate your life. At number 122, Black Ops 1, the Kaparis. It's one of the worst SMGs in COD history by far. It had a small 20-round mag, the recoil was horrendous, the damage was super low, and despite it being able to be dual-wielded, it was a terrible idea because it was wildly inaccurate. I actually debated over whether to put this gun above or below the Uzi, but ultimately, I don't think it matters where they are because they're bad. It's at number 122. Come on. Guys, before we go any further, if you are looking for a new gaming PC or a gaming laptop, look no further than Apex Gaming PCs and check out the Chaos DEFCON line. That's right. Team Chaos has their own line of customizable gaming PCs. The link is at the top of the description. Use code CHAOS for a discount. And now we get to 121. Black Ops 1. Do you guys see a pattern here? The PM63. Once again, steamy hot garbage. Like many SMGs in the original Black Ops, unfortunately, it had a solid rate of fire and low recoil, but the damage in the 20-round mag, it just didn't work. This thing only had 20 rounds in the mag despite firing it over 900 rounds per minute. That doesn't jive. You're going to be reloading a lot. It only gets higher. Well, it only gets a higher spot than the Uzi because it was a tad easier to control, although that's not saying a lot. It was still hot garbage. At number 120 today, the COD World War II WAF 28. Now, many, many people love this gun in the beta, but when the full game came out, Sledgehammer drove it into the ground with the Nerf Hammer. Horrible damage, long reload animation, and some pretty hefty recoil to boot. It made it almost unusable beyond close range. It was no good. And yes, I know SMGs are close range weapons, but you'll see as we go throughout this list that a lot of these in the upper tier category, they're like mid-range assault rifles. At 119, the Modern Warfare 2019 Striker 45. It's supposed to be the new version of the UMP-45, but it doesn't have the good stuff people liked about that UMP. The mag is smaller, I mean, the damage is inconsistent, the range sucks, and the recoil is unpredictable. The Striker, it was bad. Now, it's definitely better in multiplayer than it is in Warzone, but neither one is very good. Now, I know there's going to be some people argue with me on this one, but I'm sticking to my guns. You get it? You see what I did there? At number 118 today, the Infinite Warfare FHR-40. It was supposed to be a futuristic interpretation of the P90, but it was worse in pretty much every way. You expect from a P90 a huge mag, high fire rate, low damage, but unlike most other P90s, the FHR-40 had extremely high recoil. It made it unusable beyond close range. Plus, Infinite Warfare was a super mobile game, so good luck tracking your targets with this thing. It didn't work. At 117, the Advanced Warfare AMR-9. I love dogging this gun, I really do. 5-round burst SMG, first ever, right? Horrendous range, super inconsistent damage. A burst SMG needs to be super powerful and super consistent. Otherwise, what's the point of using it? It was one of the worst burst weapons in COD history, not just Advanced Warfare, and it's definitely a lower tier SMG. We haven't even cracked into the top 100. At 116, the Black Ops 2 PDW-57. Now, at one point, the gun would have been probably in the top 10, okay? But after a hefty nerf, it became one of the worst guns in Black Ops 2. Bouncy, weak, unpredictable, and not versatile in any way. It was a marshmallow shooter in the biggest sense, and it had one of the steepest falls from grace in COD history. We're not going to go with the launch day. We're going to go with the current State. At number 115, the Black Ops 1 Spectre. We're going to get most of these Black Ops 1 guns out of the way. Now, it was the most accurate automatic weapon in Black Ops 1. That doesn't mean people liked it. It had a high fire rate, but very low damage and somewhat long reload animations, which made it a bizarre weapon to take into battle, especially when it was dealing as little as 20 damage per shot. Nobody was going to take this with them onto maps like Nuketown and Summit if they were actually trying to go for a win or go for high kills. At number 114, the Black Ops 3 HG40. Yes, we are ranking DLC weapons as well. It's one of the most disappointing DLC weapons of all time. I was hyped for this thing. It was a futuristic MP40, but it wasn't. High recoil, low rate of fire, super inconsistent damage. It quickly became one of the most talked about weapons in Black Ops 3 because of how crap it actually was. It was patched once or twice, but even after that, it was no good. This had to be one of the most disappointing supply drop guns in COD history, and this was at a time where you weren't even guaranteed to ever get it and get to experience it, but you weren't missing anything. At number 113 today, the COD 4 Scorpion. I don't like the gun, and I know some of you like it, but it's not getting a very high spot for me. It fired fast, it had zero recoil, but it was also extremely weak. It had this little baby tiny magazine and a painfully long reload animation, which once again, you don't want a long reload animation with an SMG. In hardcore, yes, it was nice because of the handling, but in core modes, the time to kill was just way too inconsistent. We're not ranking or judging off a hardcore mode because everything's pretty good in hardcore. At number 112, the Black Ops 1 MPL. Low damage profile SMG, but it did have a high rate of fire and one of the biggest default mags in the entire SMG class, which is saying something, but the range, terrible. The recoil, terrible. There wasn't much reason to take this thing over every other SMGs or even like the AK-74U or a rifle or the FMOS, whatever. Nobody used it, and it's not hard to see why. At number 111, 111, Modern Warfare 2's Mini Uzi. It was faithfully copy-pasted into MW2 from COD 4, but due to the changes in the gameplay, it just couldn't keep up with the other weapons. The Mini Uzi fired fast and it kicked a lot, but it didn't hit very hard, which made it very frustrating to use when compared to other rifles and SMGs in Modern Warfare 2. Nobody was ever going for nukes with the Mini Uzi unless you were just trying to test your own patience. At number 110, the Advanced Warfare SN6. Who remembers this gun? It was actually in the very first multiplayer trailer, I do believe. It was the blue and yellow colorway. The SN6 was a 4-6 shot kill, and it had the lowest recoil in the SMG class. But that low damage and bad range was a trade-off, and it wasn't exactly a trade that people were willing to make. The rate of fire was low and made it feel even more sluggish. That's what it felt like. It felt like a sluggish gun, which is the complete opposite of a melt machine. I didn't like the gun, and I know I'm not alone. The damage was way too low for people to want to use it, and I can honestly say I probably only used it once in my entire Advanced Warfare life cycle. At number 109, the Black Ops 3 AK-74U. Now, I love the AK-74U. You're going to see some versions of it way up higher than this, but not the BO3 version. It had the same lower fire rate and vertical recoil you'd expect, but the damage, it was super inconsistent, and the range was, let's just call it, embarrassing. Now, the legacy of the AK-74U that it has in COD, I would have expected it to be way better from the Black Ops 3 version. I know I'm not alone here, and I know a lot of people were disappointed. At number 108, the Advanced Warfare MP11. It's kind of a pointless gun, honestly. High rate of fire, moderate recoil, low damage. Now, in a game like Call of Duty, a 4-6 shot kill weapon, it wasn't exactly what you wanted, especially when you have to be reloading it all the time. It was a lower end of the mid-tier in Advanced Warfare, and that's not saying much. At number 107 today, the COD 4 Mini Uzi. Now, the Mini Uzi was a melt machine at close range, but once you backed it up, it lost almost all of its appeal. Super fast fire rate, but super low damage, and it didn't have very good range values either. It made it a true close quarters weapon, and even then, there were better close range guns in COD 4. The Mini Uzi was cool, don't get me wrong. It was fun to use, but in terms of stats, it wasn't any good. At number 106 today, the Modern Warfare remastered MAC-10. It's in the game basically as a reskin of the Mini Uzi, but with slightly lower recoil patterns. Wasn't amazing. Had a decent time to kill up close, I guess. There's not a lot to say about it. It was going to blow your socks off, but I guess it was solid enough. I had to put it somewhere. At number 105, the COD World War II M1928. It has a lot of the same problems as the WAF did that we talked about earlier, but to a slightly less degree. It fired really quickly, it kicked like a mule, but the reload animation was slightly faster and the damage was slightly more forgiving. It wasn't amazing, don't get me wrong, but it was more usable than the WAF, so I gave it a slightly higher spot. You have to remember, we're ranking a lot of guns here. At number 104, let's see if you remember this one. The Modern Warfare Remastered Fang 45. It's one of the most forgettable DLC guns in COD history. It was this weird SMG with some huge iron sights and low recoil, but super unimpressive range. It wasn't good. It wasn't bad. It was kind of just sitting there in the middle of the pack saying, use me, and nobody did. I'm kind of pissed they added DLC weapons to Modern Warfare Remastered, but hey, I guess I'd rather it be bad than overpowered. I don't know. Did you ever even use the Fang 45? At number 103, the Ghost CBJ MS. This is one of the least used guns in Ghost. It was a very fast-firing SMG with integrated armor-piercing rounds, which sounds freaking awesome, but it also had very low damage and a very high recoil pattern, which made it hard to use beyond point-blank range in a game like Ghost with bigger and more open maps. The gun just didn't help you out. Most people just walked right by it in the class menu. At number 102, you see a pattern here? Lots of AW guns, lots of Black Ops 1 guns, lots of COD 4. The SAC 3. Another SMG that killed in 4-6 bullets that nobody used because it wasn't the ASM-1. And honestly, can you blame anybody? No. The SMGs in AW were vastly outclassed by the ASM-1, so even if they were decent, you didn't see them online. You didn't see them on the battlefield. The SAC, it was slightly redeemed in the sense that it could be dual-wielded. It made it slightly better, but it wasn't exactly a popular choice no matter what. And I always wondered, how did they change and do the reload animation with that dual-wield? It was magic. At number 101, the Black Ops 4 MX9. It's weird. It's one of those guns that needed to be loaded up with attachments in order to be viable, but even after you kitted it out, it was only mid-tier. Nothing special, not a whole lot to write home about. Some people made it work, it did work with it, but it was super middle of the road in the grand scheme of things, and we have so many to rank, I just can't give it a higher spot. And now we've reached 100. The 100th best or worst gun, however you want to say it, SMG-wise in COD history, is the Modern Warfare 2019 Uzi. I mean, has the Uzi ever been good in any COD game? I don't know. That's debatable. I guess the 2019 version is a little better than the rest because of the higher damage, but the low rate of fire and the bouncy recoil ruined it. Plus, despite having the whole gunsmith at your disposal, it was difficult to get the Uzi out properly. I just don't think it's very good. While you may have been able to make it work with some kind of lab kit out, not many people did. At number 99, the Black Ops 1 Scorpion. It was one of the slower SMGs in Black Ops 1, and from a damage standpoint, it wasn't special, but it was one of the few SMGs in the game that you could run akimbo. That's cool. It was underrated. The akimbo version was. It's not top tier, but it was underrated. It was a fun weapon, but that doesn't mean it was a particularly good one. That's why it's at number 99. At number 98, the Black Ops 1 Mac 11. Now, I'm going to put the Mac 11 right next to the Scorpion because it was another gun that wasn't very good on its own, but in akimbo mode, you could do some stuff. It wasn't amazing, but the high rate of fire and the tight hip fire spread with steady aim made it pretty intimidating on smaller maps. So if you had that working for you, it's not the worst. But the single-wielded, is that even a thing? The regular Mac 11, it was absolute garbo. At number 97, the Black Ops Cold War Milano 821. Now, the Milano is the Cold War equivalent of the Uzi, and honestly, it's not much better. Granted, it's certainly better than the Modern Warfare Uzi, but that's not really saying much. Had a low rate of fire, pretty high damage, but even then, the damage isn't high enough to justify how few bullets are coming out of your gun compared to other people's guns. You could get something done with it, but it's not going to get you as far as some of the other SMGs, hence the lower ranking. At number 96, the Black Ops 3 HLX 4. Another weird weapon. It fired very quickly. Had an insane time to kill. But it also had this weird trait where when you pulled the trigger, the gun had to charge up for a split second. This meant you couldn't actually push with the HLX-4 due to the fact that you literally couldn't snap around corners and engage people immediately like every other SMG in the game. Time to kill was awesome, but the handling and the fire delay is what killed it. It was like a gun with a turbo and it had to spool up. At number 95, the COD World War II Irma EMP. Low recoil. Decent fire rate, average damage. It was an alright gun, you probably don't even remember it. There's not a whole lot to say about it. COD World War II had a buttload of DLC weapons, and a lot of them kind of blended together into this one massive picture. It wasn't bad, but it wasn't doing anything super special to stick out. At number 94, the Modern Warfare 2019 Fennec. Extremely fast, but the damage was so low. The recoil? Unpredictable, made it hard to take advantage of the great theoretical time to kill. Now, on smaller maps, it would do work, but the lack of versatility made it struggle on other maps. Shipment, shoot house, I mean, the Finnick is solid. Ground War and Warzone, you're probably not going to be running it. At number 93 today, the Ghost's K7. Now, I've said recently that the K7 was one of the worst guns in Ghost, and I'm going to follow through with that here. Yes, it had an integrated suppressor, which was nice, but with the bouncy recoil and the low damage profile, it just wasn't a good gun to take with you to battle. I mean, some people like the K7, but I think it should get the lowest spot on this list, honestly. And Ghost's time to kill was fast. You needed something to get work done. At number 92, the Modern Warfare 3 MP5. I've said this before. This MP5 wasn't bad or anything on its own. It simply could not keep up with the rest of the guns in the game. It was bouncy. It was inconsistent. It just didn't have the time to kill that you needed in order to be competitive in a game like Modern Warfare 3. This game was stacked with godly SMGs and rifles, so a gun like the MP5, it just didn't get any field time. At number 91 today, the Black Ops 1 MP5K. As much as people remember this version of the MP5, it wasn't that good. I know we all look with rose-tinted goggles. It bounced a lot. It was actually one of the slower automatic weapons in the game. Time to kill, not very good. Handling, not very good. It was just a mediocre. It was mediocre. That's what it was. It was better than other SMGs in the game, but that's because, like I said, Black Ops 1 had a really, really bad list of SMGs for some reason. At number 90, the World at War Thompson. It was probably the worst SMG in World at War, but that doesn't mean it was a bad gun. It just means World at War had great weapons. The Thompson kicked quite a bit, but it packed a punch. It could kill pretty quickly if you hit your shots. Plus, the firing sound was pretty awesome. It was lower tier in World at War. I would say mid-tier in the grand scheme of COD SMGs. At number 89, the Modern Warfare 2 P90. It's always had this giant magazine. It's always had a solid rate of fire, but the Modern Warfare 2 version, it was outclassed by other weapons. Yes, it was a nice spray and pray weapon, but ultimately, it wasn't very popular because other guns just got the job done faster. It had some appeal, but you're not just going to pick it when you had all those god guns. At number 88, who doesn't remember this one? The COD World War II Austin. Pretty weird looking gun in terms of stats. It's not very memorable. Average fire rate, average damage, but yes, it did have a 3-shot kill range, which is something you always want in a COD SMG. The reload was also somewhat fast for COD World War II, which was a game where most guns had kind of slow reload times. The Austin, it was decent. It was worth using, but it wasn't going to get you super excited. At number 87, the Modern Warfare 2019 AUG. You're starting SMG in Modern Warfare, and it was extremely versatile. It just didn't really fit one role super well. The default mag was very small. The fire rate wasn't very good, but the damage kind of helped. It could get some work done. It was just a weird weapon that needed a lot of special kitting out. And even after you kitted it out, it's not as good as other weapons. I think this is a fair spot. At number 86 today, the COD World War II ZK-383. It's a select fire SMG that the community was a tad split on when it was first added. Now, there was a fast firing mode and a slow firing mode. Most of the time, both of these modes, they just weren't going to do what you wanted them to. The damage profile didn't scale with the fire mode, so the slow firing mode felt weak, and the fast firing mode felt inconsistent. It's like Sledgehammer was trying to make a World War II version of the Ripper. It just didn't pan out. At number 85, the AW Repulsor. Now, you would be forgiven if you don't remember this gun. It was added to the game very late in its life cycle, but it did have some decent traits. It killed in 3-6 shots. It had a moderate rate of fire. And it was one of the only guns in the game that literally could not shoot through walls, which made it a little frustrating in certain situations. But when it was all said and done, it was an average SMG. Not too good, but not too bad. At number 84 today, the Black Ops 2 Cheekum CQB. The first ever burst SMG in COD history. People loved it. I wasn't one of them. Time to kill was pretty good in theory, but it was outclassed by most of the automatics in Black Ops 2. Some people, yes, they made it work. Yes, it has a cult following. I know they're going to be here. The fan club's going to show up. I just wasn't a fan. And I think if we're all being honest with each other, this is a decent spot for it. At number 83, the COD World War II Orso. This was your classic fast-firing but low-damage SMG that I don't have a whole lot to say about it. Time to kill was good. Range was lackluster. Reload animation was a little long. Every COD game has one of these weapons, and that's not always a good thing. It was decent, but not many people were going to flock to it. I honestly didn't even remember it. At number 82 today, the Ghost Bison. Now, this thing had a giant magazine. It was pretty hit-or-miss weapon due to the inconsistent damage. In a game like Ghost, where the time to kill was ridiculously fast, Inconsistent damage is not your friend. Bison was good for spraying and praying, but that was about it. In terms of raw time to kill, it wasn't that great. At number 81 today, the Advanced Warfare Sten. Average rate of fire, low damage, very high recoil. It kind of all seemed counterproductive. I think Sledgehammer was trying to make the gun clunky and awkward since it was from World War II, but in the end, they kind of made a gun that it just really wasn't fun to use. I guess, thanks? I don't know. You guys let me know what you think about the Sten. At number 80, that's right, we're doing a top 123. It's absolutely insane. I'm loving it. At number 80 today, the COD World War II Type 100. I actually really liked the Type 100 in this game, even if it wasn't the best. It had a low fire rate, extremely low recoil, and way better range than the other SMGs, but that fire rate was so low that the close range time to kill, it just wasn't there. It defeats the purpose of using an SMG in the first place. In hardcore, yes, the Type 100's top tier because of its versatility, but in core, it's number 80 today. At number 79, the COD World War II M38. You may not even remember this one. It was added in the Shamrock and Awe event, actually. Pretty good SMG all around. The recoil, it was noticeable, but the fire rate was good and the damage was high, so it kind of balanced out. A lot of guns in COD World War II fired pretty slowly, so it did have a relatively fast fire rate, and the damage was mid-tier. I think it's a mid-tier gun. It was pretty fun. A lot of World War II users actually enjoyed it. At number 78, let's stick with World War II. The Proto X1. This thing, it had some interesting stats. It had one of the higher fire rates for an SMG. It had pretty good damage. It killed in 4 to 5 shots, and it didn't have a lot of recoil. So it sounds really good, right? Well, it had a recoil that bounced side to side, though. And you guys know, the worst recoil pattern you can have or ask for, especially in an SMG, is side to side recoil. If it's up and down, you can manage it way better. It was fun to use, but not statistically that good. At number 73, the Black Ops 3 Sten. It was awkward. It was added to supply drops in early 2018, which was kind of weird, but it had inconsistent damage. The fire rate was pretty low. The damage could get all the way up to a 34 base, but it could also drop all the way down to 19. It was a fun gun to goof around with, but ultimately, it wasn't super amazing or anything like that. Just kind of middle of the pack, which is kind of where we're getting to here. We will end up, we're going to go through all the meat of the middle of the pack guns in this video. At number 76, the Advanced Warfare KF5. Now, it was a pretty standard gun on the surface, but the first 5 bullets of each magazine actually had increased damage. Those first 5 bullets would kill in 3 to 4 shots, but after those first 5 bullets, it would drop down to 4 to 6 shots. So it made the KF5 feel inconsistent, to say the least. It encouraged constant reloading too, which isn't really what you want to do. It was one of the better SMGs in Advanced Warfare, yes. Was it better than 75 other SMGs in COD history? I say no. At number 75 today, the COD World War II Grease Gun. This was your starting SMG in the game, and it was a slow-firing but very hard-hitting SMG that a lot of people stuck with even after they unlocked other weapons. That's saying something. The damage? It was good. The time to kill? It was pretty solid, despite the really low fire rate. Now, I like the Grease Gun. I hope it gets brought back in a future COD game, especially if we get something like COD Vanguard. At number 74, the Modern Warfare 3 UMP-45. It was heavily nerfed for Modern Warfare 2, but it was still a solid middle-of-the-pack weapon. You could rank up fast with this gun. It had a decent fire rate. Damage profile was pretty solid. Good range values. It was a mid-tier in the grand scheme of Modern Warfare 3, but it was a perfectly viable weapon that would get you ranking up quickly. But then again, there was like almost 50 guns at launch in Modern Warfare 3, so you had a lot of options. At number 73 today, the COD World War II EMP-44. Not to be mistaken with Advanced Warfare's EMP. This one had a nice damage profile, pretty solid fire rate, although that was balanced out with the handling. The recoil, it was rather bouncy. The handling speeds left something to be desired as well, but that damage profile was where it shined. It was one of the best in the SMG class, so a lot of people felt with the awkward handling, well, they dealt with it, actually, in order to take advantage of it. Plus, it had a cool name, the MP44. Come on. At number 72 today, the Black Ops 4 GKS. Super unique SMG. Super low recoil, moderate fire rate, fantastic range. It almost made it like a hybrid of an SMG and assault rifle. The time to kill wasn't the best, but the versatility made people love it. I think it's a fair spot on this list, and you'll find when a gun is versatile, even if it doesn't have the best profiles, People flock to it. At number 71, the COD World War II Bekowek? I don't even know how to say this gun, to be honest. I didn't even know this gun existed until we did this list, but apparently it's pretty good, so here you go. It fires pretty quick. I probably said that name completely wrong, too. Bechowek? I don't even know. Low recoil, okay. Carries pretty decent damage. The time to kill was on the slower side for COD World War II weapons, but it was decent enough, I think. I think it's fair enough spot. The gun was also added to the game in July of 2019, which is pretty insane when you think about it. That's more than a year and a half after COD World War II actually launched. At number 70, the Modern Warfare 2 MP5K. I've said this before. This MP5 was underwhelming. I still think that. Starting SMG and compared to the COD 4 version, it was harder to control. It was also in Modern Warfare 2, a game with ridiculous guns that could delete you before you even realized you were getting shot at. Now, on the other hand, the positive side, the glasses half full side, you could dual wield it in the game, which was pretty absurd and a lot of fun. I think it was a lower mid-tier weapon in the grand scheme of things. At number 69 today, the Modern Warfare 3 P90. Now, this may be a hot take. I'll probably get some flack for it, but I'm trying to be true and honest to this list. I think this may have been one of the best P90s in COD history, okay? The Modern Warfare 3 version was pretty similar to COD 4 and Modern Warfare 2 versions, but in the context of Modern Warfare 3, it fit better. The time to kill was slightly longer, so you could take better advantage of the huge magazine. Since you didn't have to run extended mags, you could use those attachments on other things. I think the gun was good. Not God tier, but good. At number 68 today, COD World War II, the Bliskawika? Bliskawika? Did I say that right? Another gun I didn't even know existed. Now, this had one of the best fire rates in its class and actually had very low recoil, although it was obviously traded with rather low damage. Now, a lot of people really liked the gun for how accurate it was. You could laser people from mid-range, although the number of shots you needed to drop somebody could be a little frustrating. Bliskawika? Did I say that right? At number 67, COD World War II, the Sten. This was very similar to the Type 100 in COD World War II. Slow fire rate, somewhat low damage, but great range values. The main difference between the two was the slightly higher damage that the Type 100 had, but also slightly higher recoil, so you had a little give and take there. The Sten was clearly a superior weapon, but it was still not incredible in the grand scheme of Call of Duty. At number 66, the Black Ops 2 Vector K10. It wasn't a strong weapon, but a lot of people loved it. Versatile. It was like the Modern Warfare 2 version in the sense that it didn't do a lot of damage, but it had a great fire rate and almost no recoil. Plus, Black Ops 2 gave you more attachments to mess around with and make it better, so there you go. Now, the Black Ops 2 Vector wasn't amazing, but I really liked it, and I know there's going to be people in the comments that are not happy that it's at number 66. At number 65 today, the COD World War II M267. Now, there were so many DLC guns in this game. I'm looking at these guns, and I have no idea where some of them actually came from. Very consistent gun, perhaps one of the most versatile in the entire game. It was held back, though. It was held back by a 20-round magazine, but it did have a solid fire rate and a very good damage profile. It was a good gun, one of the better DLC weapons in COD World War II, I think, but you'd be forgiven for not knowing that because it was added to the game in July of 2019. Once again, over a year and a half after the game came out. At number 64 today, the Black Ops 4 Cordite. Interesting. Interesting weapon. The damage was pretty low for an SMG in Black Ops 4, but that was countered by this giant mega magazine that you got. There was even an operator mod that would give you a 600-round mag or something like that. You can fact-check me. So you never had to reload it. It wasn't a great gun in terms of stats, but a lot of people liked it, so that has to be worth something. At number 63 today, COD World War II, the Ribby Rolls? The Ribby Rolls? The Ribby Rolls? Jeez, it's one of the weirdest looking guns in the game. It was a consistent 3-4 shot kill, had a rather low fire rate, but also very low recoil and good handling. A lot of COD games have a slow firing but accurate long range SMG, and the Ribby Rolls was one of the best examples of that. I thought it was cool by looking up the stats and stuff on it. I can't say I've ever used it. I mean, go try it if you're still interested in COD World War II. At number 62, COD World War II, the Sterling. It was added pretty late in the game, and we're getting used to that. It actually had pretty good stats. The fire rate was on the lower end, but the damage was good. It killed in 3-4 bullets most of the time. It looked consistent, had no problem keeping up with the upper tier weapons. I would almost say mid tier and a little higher, just because of the 3-4 bullets. That's pretty solid. At number 61, the Black Ops 3 PPSH-41. I hate to say this, but it was average, all things considered. It wasn't super amazing. It wasn't bad. It was middle of the road, which is weird for a gun like this and the legacy of a gun like this. Usually the PPSH is a standout weapon, but in Black Ops 3, it was kind of just sitting there. Fun to mess around with, but not a go-to weapon for high kill games. At number 60, the Modern Warfare 3 PM9. Now, this gun was actually overlooked by most of the community. I get it. It had a good fire rate, solid time to kill, but the recoil was super bouncy and the iron sights were rather obstructive. Plus, it was outclassed by every other SMG in the game. Now, I don't think the PM9 was bad at all. At number 60, we're over halfway home, so it's on the positive curve side of this list. It was buffed a tiny bit. It could have been top tier. At number 59 today, the Modern Warfare 2 Vector. The Vector is one of my favorite SMGs in Modern Warfare 2, even if it wasn't that good from a statistical standpoint. Great fire rate, no recoil, but the damage, it was bad, which made it more of a hit marker machine than most Modern Warfare 2 weapons. It felt good, though. I loved it just for that. But from that damage perspective, you had to debate whether you were going to take it over many, many other guns in that game that would just destroy. At number 58 today, the Advanced Warfare MP40. It was solid. It was actually one of the better MP40s in recent COD games. It had a pretty high fire rate, solid damage. It made it competitive with most of the SMGs in AW. Was it better than the ASM1? No, absolutely not. But was it capable of keeping up with the other guns? Yes. It was fun to use on top of that, so that's a plus. At number 57, the Black Ops Cold War PPSH-41. Now, so far, the PPSH has had a bit of a mixed bag in Black Ops Cold War. High fire rate, that's good. A lot of great attachments, that's good. Low damage, not so good in this weird recoil pattern that takes some getting used to. It's a solid gun, but in the grand scheme of Black Ops Cold War and Call of Duty as a whole, it's not that impressive. Maybe it's just a little too early. I mean, maybe as of right now, though, I think it's a fair spot. At number 56, the COD World War II Nambu Type 2. All around solid SMG. Good damage, good fire rate, low recoil, just about everything you would check off on a list when you're trying to find a good weapon to use. Nothing incredible, but it would get the job done reliably, enough to be an upper tier, maybe even the lower end of high tier. Moving right along to number 55, the Infinite Warfare Karma 45, basically a futuristic version of the Vector, and a lot of people loved it. Huge magazine, high fire rate, solid damage, made for a weapon you could spray and pray and not have to worry about reloading. Was it a top-tier weapon in Infinite Warfare? No, but it was a solid SMG. At number 54, the Black Ops 3 Weevil. It was basically a futuristic P90. Had a lot of the same traits. Low damage, but giant magazine and a high fire rate. It made it, once again, good for spraying and praying, despite not having this fantastic raw time to kill. Now, ultimately, it was a good weapon. A lot of people loved it. Statistically, I think it belongs at number 54. It had a huge fan club. That's not how I rank things, but I think it's a good spot. At number 53 today, the Ghost Vepr. Now, compared to the other SMGs, the Vepr had a huge magazine, very low recoil. It made it usable beyond close range. Compared to the MTAR-X, it had a slightly longer time to kill, but it was still good. It was versatile. I think people may have slept on the gun a lot. I used it a lot in the very beginning of COD Ghost. I know the MTAR was better, but if you wanted a change of pace, I think the Vepr was right there for you. At number 52, the COD World at War. World at War now, not COD World War II. Type 100. Compared to the other SMGs in World at War, it was weak, but it was accurate. It barely moved when you pulled the trigger. It was like an assault rifle, and the damage was solid enough to be consistent. Now, the low recoil of this gun made it the best SMG for mid-range engagements in World at War. I think it was underrated. I really, really do. I enjoyed that gun. I have a lot of playing time with the Type 100 in that game. At number 51, the Black Ops 3 Pharaoh. Now, some people swore the Pharaoh was top tier. I don't see it. Four-round burst SMG, essentially a pocket version of the M8A7, but way less consistent with the damage. It could one-burst people up close, yes. But once you backed up, it would take 2 to 3 to drop somebody, and that's assuming the target doesn't have good movement. Burst SMGs didn't do very well in jetpack games, and while the Pharaoh did have potential, it just wasn't quite as good as some of the others. At number 50 today, the Infinite Warfare Trencher. Now, it was a little weird to get a World War II era weapon in a game like Infinite Warfare, but here it is, and it was good. It was actually one of the best SMGs in that game. It had a lower fire rate than most, but great damage and range. It made it formidable at close and mid-range. It was fun to mess around with. It was a solid choice for most maps, and I like the name, Trencher. At number 49 today, the Black Ops Cold War MAC-10. It has been heavily nerfed since it was added to the game, but it's still solid. Super high fire rate, solid damage, a lot of great attachments, make things even better. Now, it isn't as good as it once was, no, but the time to kill is good. It's a high-tier SMG in the grand scheme of Call of Duty, and I think number 49 is a good spot. At number 48, the Black Ops 2 MP7. This thing was heavily nerfed for Modern Warfare 3 over to Black Ops 2, but it was still a fan favorite because it had that smooth-as-butter handling. Black Ops 2 version had lower damage and higher recoil, but it kept those super clean iron sights, great handling speeds, and that solid damage profile. It was a good choice for leveling up early in Black Ops 2. I liked it. You probably liked it. We all used it some. It just wasn't high tier. At number 47, the Black Ops 3 DIY 11, the infamous nail gun. Yes, it would fire projective nails at your enemy, meaning you had to lead your shots in order to hit them at range. However, if those nails made contact, you were rewarded with great damage, and since they were nails, they would stick into the enemies and walls. You could actually go pick them up like ballistic knives, meaning you could always have ammo, even without scavenger. The Do-It-Yourself 11 was a cool gun. I think this is a good spot. It's hard to rank that one. At number 46, the Modern Warfare 2019 PP19 Bison. It was underrated, if you ask me. The mag was giant. The recoil was low. The damage was respectable. It's not going to kill as fast as an MP5 or an MP7, but that giant magazine and great handling makes it worth something, especially in Modern Warfare. If you're still playing the game, go give it a shot. At number 45, the Black Ops Cold War KSP-45. Now, despite being a burst SMG, this one's good. It was hot garbage when the game came out, but it's been buffed once or twice. It's now in a good spot. It's getting a lot of field usage. Granted, Treyarch has been making a lot of balancing changes in the game, so it's possible the KSP ends up getting nerfed again. But right now, I think it's a solid spot for it. In terms of burst SMGs, which is hard sometimes, the KSP-45 is a solid one. At number 44 today, the Infinite Warfare MACTAV 45, the remake of the classic UMP-45. Now, it was pretty powerful and a lot of fun to use. Slower rate of fire, very high damage. It could kill in 3 bullets for pretty respectable distances. It's not the best version of the UMP, no, but it's pretty close. I mean, if you ask me, I think you know what UMP will be better, but we'll talk about that one a little later in the list. At number 43, the Black Ops Cold War LC-10. It's a new addition to the game. It's been getting a lot of usage. The fire rate is decent, the damage is okay, but the range is where it sets it apart. It has really good range, arguably one of the best mid-range weapons in the game, and it's an SMG. It's got that snappy handling and awesome time to kill. Plus, it's been getting a lot of extra usage in Warzone, so that'll push it up a few more spaces compared to other SMGs on today's list. At number 42, the Modern Warfare Remastered PK PSD9. What? The Pocket M16. 3-round burst SMG. It's good. Kills with 3 bullets from pretty solid ranges and fires fast enough to stay competitive if you missed your first burst. Yes, it was outclassed by a lot of base weapons in Modern Warfare Remastered, but it was fun to use. And the final one on today's list, part 2 in the books, Infinite Warfare, the RPR Evo, the Ripper. Futuristic remake of the fan favorite Ripper from Ghost. SMG-AR hybrid. You can hit a button swap between the two versions. You had the super fast firing SMG mode and the slower firing AR mode, and both of them were pretty good. It was higher tier in Infinite Warfare, although I think number 41 is a fair spot in the grand scheme of Call of Duty. At number 40 today. Now remember, there's 123, so at number 40, that's a very respectable spot. That is on the upper mid tier going into high tier. The Black Ops 3 Razorback. Now, the gun was completely broken during the Black Ops 3 beta, but nerfed into the ground when the full game came out. That's not to say it was bad, though. The Razorback had fantastic range, and despite not being very strong at close range, it actually had a better mid-range time to kill than some of the other assault rifles and LMGs in the game. Now, you had to treat it more like an assault rifle than an SMG, and if you did that, it was really, really viable. At number 39 today, the COD 4 P90. This is one of my favorite P90s in COD history. This version featured low recoil, a very, very, very big magazine, a high fire rate, and moderate damage. It was great for mowing down groups of enemies on shipment or vacant. Also, while staying mobile enough to get out of the way. It was a great SMG and certainly high tier in the grand scheme of COD SMGs. Guys, before we go any further, if you get anything in the Black Ops Cold War item shop or the Warzone item shop, whether it be Rambo, whether it be John McClane or anything else, consider using support a creator code CHAOS, all caps. Make sure you send me a picture so you can make it in a video just like this. Thank you to all the Team Chaos people that support with the code. You can send it to me on Instagram, Facebook, my business, email, Twitter, wherever. Thank you so much, and thank you for Call of Duty for including me in the program. At number 38, the Infinite Warfare Viper. Well, VPR, I call it the Viper. It was an interesting SMG. It featured two magazines, yep, on the left and the right side of the gun, which gave it this really unique reload animation that you all probably remember, even if you didn't play a lot of Infinite Warfare like me. The VRP also had a pretty solid time to kill, and since you had two magazines, you could spray and pray without worrying about constant reloads. I think it was pretty good in terms of stats, I guess. It gets a few extra style points because of the dual mag and the reload animation for me. At number 37, the Modern Warfare 2019 ISO. It was kind of a counterpart to the MP5, but it actually, well, it never really caught on the same way due to some differences. It had a tad more vertical recoil than the MP5, but the damage and time to kill, it was also slightly worse. So it was easier to control in return for, well, slightly worse damage. Was it good? Yeah. Was it top tier? Almost. High tier, yes. Top tier, no, but there's a lot of other guns on this list that did the job better. At number 36, the Black Ops Cold War Bullfrog. Now, it was written off by a lot of people when Black Ops Cold War came out due to the low rate of fire and the lack of flare, but the Bullfrog is now one of the most popular SMGs in the game. The mag is huge. Damage low, yes, but the headshot multiplier is massive. It gives it one of the fastest time to kills in the entire game as long as you're aiming high. It is a high skill weapon, but if you're willing to put the work and time in, it's a solid choice. At number 35 today, the Infinite Warfare HVR. Now, I hated this gun, but as time went on, people started to figure it out. It grew on me. The HVR is basically a futuristic UMP-45, and it's even called the UMP in the game file, so you should know what to expect. The time to kill? Solid. And it was tough to control. That gave it more of a learning curve, if you will, but it made it more satisfying to play with if you were doing well with it. At number 34 today, the Ghost Vector CRB. This is easily the best vector in COD history, hands down. Very fast, very versatile, tons of field usage back in the day. It was super strong. It could drop you in the blink of an eye if somebody got the drop on you. Plus, since the health in Ghost was so low, the time to kill was so fast, the vector maintained that power for a longer distance. It was a very, very good SMG. Guys, we're debating on ranking every assault rifle in Call of Duty. Is that a dumb venture, or should we give it a try? You let me know in the comment section. At number 33 today, the COD World War II MP40. I like this one. It wasn't as broken as the World at War version, although that's probably for the better. The World War II MP40 fired a little faster. It hit a little lighter, but it made it a proper competitor to the PPSH-41, which we'll talk about a little later. It wasn't as good as the PPSH, but it was certainly a viable SMG, and I think it was higher tier. At number 32 today, the Black Ops Cold War MP5. Now, Black Ops Cold War had one of the best MP5s in COD history. Compared to the other MP5s, the recoil was more vertical than horizontal this time, which was good, and the damage was tremendous. You want a little bonus? The range? It was deceptively good. The MP5 was once again the go-to sweaty gun in Black Ops Cold War, and I don't know when the next COD game will be or what it will be with an MP5, if it will have one, but if it does, it's going to be a sweaty gun. Come on, let's be real. At number 31, the Modern Warfare 2019 P90. Now, this is one of my favorite P90s in COD history, and I think most people will agree it's probably the best. It had the same high fire rate, big magazine you expect, but this one had better iron sights, way more attachments, and far more intimidating damage than the other one. This P90 slaps, let's be real. And if you passed over it, go give it another look if you're still playing Modern Warfare. But if you're still playing Modern Warfare, well, why are you playing Modern Warfare? At number 30, the Black Ops Cold War AK-74U. Now, the Cold War version has been spammed like crazy. It's not hard to see why. The fire rate is low compared to other automatics in the game, but the damage is where it makes it up. It can drop people fast. And since you have the gunsmith at your disposal now, you can kit it out to give you even better range values and allow it to outgun some of the assault rifles. You heard me right. It's really good. I think it's a fair spot for it. Granted, it might get nerfed and this video may sound stupid in the future, but for now, just look at the date. At number 29, the Black Ops 4 Spitfire. Come on, insane. In a game like Black Ops 4, where the time to kill was much longer and extended, the gunfights took more time, this thing could delete you before you even realized what was going on, and that's good. Top tier SMG in Black Ops 4 for sure. Pretty high tier one in the grand scheme of Call of Duty SMGs. At number 28, fan favorite, the Black Ops 2 Peacekeeper. The first DLC weapon in COD history, an SMG-AR hybrid. Solid fire rate, low recoil, fantastic range, and a super beefy firing sound that everybody remembers. It was a very, very memorable weapon. And it kicked off the COD trend of DLC weapons. And yes, that trend has gotten a little out of hand, but now, but the Peacekeeper, it was hype. At number 27, the Black Ops 4 Daemon 3 XB. Now, when this gun was added to the game, people wrote it off. But once again, as time went on, hindsight's 20/20, people realized how strong it was. It's one of the best burst SMGs in COD history, and the time to kill on it is fantastic if you can hit your shots and aim high. Black Ops 4 had some freaking insane SMGs. We're not done yet. At number 26, the Black Ops 3 Vesper. Now, there was a period in time where this gun was broken, and despite being nerfed, it's still strong. Remember, we're going with the current state of guns. The Vesper fires extremely quickly. It kicks a lot, but despite having low damage per bullet, the TTK on this thing was insane. It was frustrating to go up against the Vesper, especially pre-patch. At number 25, we are getting into the cream of the crop, my friends, the Ghost Ripper. One of the, I think it was the first hybrid weapon. It was one of the first hybrid weapons, I'm not for sure. Fact check me. And it merged an SMG and assault rifle with the touch of a button so you could toggle between them. Well, the Peacekeeper was hybrid too, but you couldn't toggle. Both the SMG and the AR versions of the Ripper were solid. In SMG mode, it was arguably one of the best SMGs in Ghost. Plus, as one of the first DLC weapons in COD history, it was super, super hype and still a fan favorite to this day. At number 24 today, the Modern Warfare 3 PP90 M1. Bullet hose. Ridiculously fast. It did kick a lot. The time to kill, though, made up for it. It made it a fan favorite. If you could control the recoil, it was a god gun. It had one of the fastest times to kill in the entire game. You could even slap rapid fire on it. Yes, you could, and make it even stupider, if that's even a word. Everybody loved this gun. At number 23 today, the Infinite Warfare ERAD. Pretty much the only SMG you'd see in competitive play. It was an energy weapon with a 30-round mag, a solid fire rate, and some really, really good damage. Now, the range, it was deceptively good, and the reload animation was a little bit long, but it was still a great gun. That one negative doesn't outweigh all the positives. It wasn't hard to see why the ERAD was more popular than the other SMGs in Infinite Warfare. At number 22, the Black Ops 3 CUDA. Basically, the Black Ops 3 version of the MP5. Solid fire rate, good damage, good range, a little bit of bouncy recoil. You could get used to it, though. It was your starting SMG, and it remained a popular pick throughout the game's lifecycle because the damage was so good, and it had a very simple learning curve. I think number 22 is a fair spot. It was an all-around really good gun. At number 21, you may not even remember this one. The Infinite Warfare Rajin EMX, Rajin EMX, burst SMG once again, arguably the best burst in COD history. I don't know. Had a fantastic time to kill. It was deceptively versatile for a gun like this. Now, I've said it before. Burst SMGs generally don't go very well in jetpack games, but this one, it broke that stereotype. It was fantastic, but since it was added to the game so late in the lifecycle, a lot of you probably never even used it. At number 20, the World at War PPSH-41. And you're probably asking me and yourself, if this isn't number 20, what the heck is left? Just stick around. The Resident Meat Grinder. Everybody already knows. Fired at 1,250 rounds per minute by default. Damage pretty generous. Only needed 3 to 4 shots to connect without stopping power in order to get somebody, which was absurd for a gun that was firing this quickly. It will always be one of my favorite SMGs in COD history. While I think it lacks versatility and it knocks it down a few pegs, it's still one of the higher tier weapons on this list. At number 19, the COD 4 MP5. One of the best starting weapons in COD history. It was powerful. It was versatile. It killed in 3 to 5 bullets with no stopping power, and it had really good handling. It was snappy. It was only held back by the recoil, which many players despise. But if you stuck to close quarters, it wasn't a big deal. Was it the best SMG in COD 4? Not quite. I think there was one more gun in the game that had it beat, which we'll talk about very soon. At number 18 today, the COD World War II PPSH-41. Yes, I ranked it above the World at War 1. It was one of the MLG weapons of choice. It got spammed harder in this game than it did at World at War, which is, that's saying something. Now, it wasn't very historically accurate due to the lower rate of fire, but it was a fantastic gun, and it was super versatile. I mean, it carried a great time to kill from close range all the way to the ends of mid-range. It's not my favorite PPSH personally, but in terms of stats, I had to rank it above. At number 17 today, the Modern Warfare 2019 MP7, one of my favorite SMGs in this game. Super snappy, easy to control, damage per bullet little low, but the fire rate made up for it. It was very versatile, and since it was so easy to control, you could load it up with all the best range attachments to make it even more. I love the gun, but there is one better MP7 we'll talk about later, and I'll give you three guesses. You probably only need one. At number 16 today, the Black Ops 1 AK-74U. Come on, far and away the best SMG in that game, but it didn't have a lot of competition. It fired fast, it hit super hard, had good handling, it had tons of great attachments, including a noob tube. Yes, because everybody thought a noob tube on an SMG was a good idea. It's one of my favorite guns in the OG Black Ops and one of the best SMGs in COD history. This was a baby assault rifle. At number 15 today, the Black Ops 2 Scorpion Evo. Loved it. Stupid fire rate, 1,250 rounds per minute. Now, the damage per shot wasn't the best, but if you hit the bullets, well, if your bullets hit their target, it was dumb. It was game over. Even at mid-range, if you could somehow hit your shots with the Evo, it was busted. Now, I don't think it was as overpowered as other people because of that recoil, but it was, come on, it just cut people in half. At number 14 today, the Modern Warfare 2 UMP-45. I've said it before that this is one of the most underappreciated guns in COD history and Modern Warfare 2. It can kill in two bullets, people, from distance, all while carrying a mobility of a submachine gun. In a game like Modern Warfare 2 where everything was busted, the UMP-45 managed to stand out for its sheer power and versatility, but it never seems to get talked about like some of the other guns in that game, which I don't understand. At number 13, the Black Ops 4 Micro MG 9mm. Have you ever wanted a death machine in the body of an SMG? Here you go. The Micro MG. It's a minigun. You can run around. You can rev it up. You can erase people in the blink of an eye. The time to kill in this thing is one of the best in the entire game, and in a game like Black Ops 4, like I've said, where the time to kill is so long, this is dumb. Some even called it overpowered. Do you agree? I do. At number 12, the Black Ops 4 VMP. It was a fan favorite spam gun in Black Ops 3. And while I don't think the Black Ops 4 remake was quite as good, it was still good. Solid fire rate, solid damage, easy recoil, great range, versatility. It was a fan favorite for those who managed to get their hands on it. And I may get some heat for saying it, but it's a little worse than the Black Ops 3 version. It was close. So here you go. At number 11. The Black Ops 3 VMP. Yep, we already know, right? Despite being one of the first guns you unlocked in Black Ops 3, it was one of the best in the entire game. Fast fire rate, easy handling, great time to kill, both close and mid-range. It was one of the most popular guns for competitive matches and pub stomping. It's basically this game's equivalent of the MSMC. Yes, we're going to segue. Okay, we started with 123 guns. We are now down to the top 10. Here we go. The best of the best. The Black Ops 2 MSMC takes the number 10 spot today. One of the most popular competitive weapons in COD history. Decent fire rate, hefty recoil, but it was the damage and the range values. The versatility is what set it above the rest of the weapons in Black Ops 2 and made it so popular with competitive players and pub stompers alike. Maybe one day we'll get an SMG that is this good again. At number 9 today, the Advanced Warfare ASM-1. One of the most overpowered SMGs in COD history. Huge, huge magazine. Solid fire rate. Ridiculous damage profile. It made it better than most of the rifles at mid-range in AW. Far and away, the best SMG in Advanced Warfare and a high-tier SMG in the grand scheme of Call of Duty. Unfortunately, it was locked behind supply drops. At number 8 today, the Black Ops 4 SOG 9mm. I think this is one of the most broken guns in Black Ops history. It fired fast, it barely kicked, it had one of the best times to kill the entire game. It even got to a point that certain attachments, on the SOG were actually banned in competitive play because they were too good. Did I mention? You could dual wield it if you want to. It was busted, and it's definitely a top-tier SMG in COD history. At number 7 today, the Ghost MTAR X. This is one of the most spam competitive guns we've ever seen. Super versatile, and I forgot it was an SMG. For some reason, I thought it was an assault rifle, but whatever. It's because it was that versatile. It dominated pubs, competitive, everything in COD Ghost. It was the most used gun in Call of Duty Ghost, hands down. Definitely a top 10 SMG, almost a top 5. At number 6, the COD 4 AK-74U. I know this is going to be a super hot take. Hear me out. It was the best SMG in COD 4. We're not going to argue about that, right? It was the counterpart to the MP5. It featured almost identical damage and fire rates, but far easier recoil to control. It kicks straight up and down, which is easy to tag people at mid-range and take advantage of its strength, especially with stopping power. The COD 474U was nuts, and I know it flies under the radar and nobody thought it was going to be here, but go back and try it. And now we've reached the top five. The Black Ops 4 Switchblade X9. This is one of the most OP DLC weapons we've ever seen. It was an absurdly fast SMG with one of the best times to kill the entire game, which is saying a lot in a slower TTK game like Black Ops 4. I know I'm going to say that till I'm blue in the face. Had extremely fast handling, fantastic damage. It put it near the top of the entire tier list for Black Ops 4. If you haven't played BO4 in a while, go try the gun. You may have overlooked it, and then you'll understand why it's the top, why it's the fifth best gun out of 123. At number four, the Black Ops 3 XMC. This was the futuristic remake of the MSMC from Black Ops 2, and it was one of the rare cases where the remake was actually better than the original. You heard me right. It had a better fire rate, better handling, better damage, and it was first added to the game. People were crying about they needed a nerf on it because it was blatantly overpowered. Even after the nerfs, the XMC is insane. At number three today, the World at War MP40. Easily the best gun in World at War. It was, if you played back then, drop a like. The game launched in 2008. The gun was never patched. It could kill in two bullets without stopping power, and you could put a 64-round mag attachment on it if you wanted to be the biggest D-bag in the lobby. It could have been number one, let's be real. At number two today, the Modern Warfare 2019 MP5. If we're talking about standard COD multiplayer, it's hands down the best we've ever gotten. Snappy, powerful, fast, versatile. It checks off every category. It blows my mind that it was never nerfed. Even after dominating every tournament and getting by far the most playtime out of any SMG, the 2019 MP5 was never nerfed. It was hands down the best version of the gun we've ever gotten, for standard multiplayer at least. But there's one gun that I deem better. One gun that I deem the best out of the entire COD history SMG list. We've reached the end. Do you know what it is? Can you remember what hasn't been talked about? It's the Modern Warfare 3 MP7. This is only one of the best SMG. It's not only the best SMG, it's one of the best guns in COD history. It was a pocket LMG. Huge magazine, great fire rate, super low recoil, fantastic range. It was overpowered and guess what? Never nerfed. It made it one of the most popular guns in the entire Modern Warfare trilogy. This is definitively the best SMG in COD history. Nobody will ever convince me otherwise. It was broken. It remains broken. If you've never tried it, you don't have a valid argument. And there you have it, my friends. We just ranked every single Call of Duty SMG, including DLC weapons. Let us know what other massive ranking list you would like to see in the future. Thank you for all the love. If you made it to the end of the video, you're the best. I'll see you guys soon.